guys hear me? Welcome to Hacking the Wetware. I appreciate you sitting through one last talk before you get to drink a lot of beer. I'm going to be covering a lot of information about social engineering today. Who here is familiar with social engineering? That's awesome. Awesome. I'm covering some new content today, stuff I haven't put out there before, some baby pictures of me. It's going to be cool. If you were on my flight over from SFO, then you probably already got a sneak peek of this talk, as I did repeat it to myself underneath my breath 20 times. So, who am I? I'm Rachel Topak. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Social Proof Security. We teach people about what opens them up to social engineering risk by helping them step into the shoes of a human-based hacker. We have social engineering trainings, workshops, and pen tests, and we actually give them live targets so that they can try it and see it and solidify those learnings. In my spare time, I sit on the board of the nonprofit Women in Security and Privacy, WISP, which trains and promotes women to lead in these fields, and we just opened up our first European chapter. Woo woo! No, thanks. I got my start hacking at DEF CON, as you can see in this picture. I'm in a glass booth hacking a real company that I can't disclose or I will get sued in front of 400 people. As you can see in this picture, we'll get into a little bit more detail about what's going on here. But first, you might be wondering, what exactly is my origin story? Cute baby picture. Aww. So my path to where I am now is a little bit non-linear. Probably like many people in this audience, I didn't go to school for information security. But if I was paying attention back then, I could have probably guessed that something like this would have happened. Here I am in the 90s, holding a large chunk of continuous feed printer paper. I had a knack for picking up the best tech. And I really liked ripping the holes off this perforated paper. So I started learning about printers at a very young age. And then I started realizing I'm a loud, rambunctious child. I still am. And I have a flair for the imagination. In fact, my first full sentence was, "Things come to life in my imagination." Extremely creepy. My parents hated it, but it's true. And I started being interested in human behavior and technology from a young age. I also started getting interested in persuasion, specifically because I needed to talk my way out of detention. I got detention a lot. And I didn't realize back then that this thing had a name. It was called social engineering. But I went to college for neuroscience and behaviorism, and I became a special needs teacher, then a community manager in tech, then a human factors researcher, and then, one day, DEF CON happened. DEF CON is a hacker conference attended by about 25,000 people every year. Raise your hand if you've been to DEF CON. You don't have to. I'm not social engineering you. Okay, cool. One of those people was my husband, Evan, and he calls me from DEF CON many years ago, and he's like, "Rachel, you need to get here." And I'm like, "I'm non-technical, and then it's going to go right over my head. I don't want to sit in the audience and feel like an idiot." And he's like, "Well, they have this thing where you get into a glass booth, and you call a live target, and you hack them live, and you can win prizes." And I'm a competitive person, a rambunctious person, so naturally, I buy a ticket to Vegas that night, pack a bag in 10 seconds, and I'm out. He was right. I was the type of person to call my cable service provider and try and get the bill lowered every single month, with moderate success. I went on to become the winner of the DEF CON Social Engineering Captured Flag, second place, lost two times to different men named Chris each time, but the top two win, so suckos. Where we get into that glass booth and we actually hack people. I'll give you a little bit more context about this because it can sound a little scary if you don't know what the SECTF Social Engineering Capture the Flag is. So the purpose of this is social engineering through education. So we're not trying to hack companies to make them feel stupid or try and expose them for being frauds or anything like that. We want them to get an understanding of where their vulnerabilities are. So we do dynamic human pen testing. But they're not aware that they're a target for DEF CON. So we don't tell them beforehand. That would kind of ruin the DEF CON SECTF. Instead, what we do is we do that dynamic human pen testing, and then we send them a report afterwards. Usually, they graciously accept it. In my case, 2 years ago, they were very angry and threatened to sue. It's fine. But in general, that's how it works. Now, you might be asking yourself, "Rachel, what exactly is social engineering? How would one define it on Wikipedia?" And you might get the answer. Social engineering is any act that influences a person to take an action that may or may not be in their best interest. And people use social engineering to hack companies, but they also use it to convince children to eat their vegetables. So social engineering in and of itself is not just a bad thing. We use it all the time. It's basically just persuasion. Social engineering tactics are considered to be one of the greatest risks to information security, as many of you know. As of 2017, research now shows that the majority of cyber attacks now start with social engineering. And the cost of each cyber attack is on the rise, with each cyber attack now costing a company, on average, $11.7 million, according to Poneman. And I was curious about what that amount of money looked like in real life, but Google didn't have images with amounts in $1 US bills, so I present for your amusement, 1 million USD, 11.7 times exactly, I measured it, just to give you an idea of what exactly that looks like. Most attacks we see today start with a phishing email or a phishing call. That's basically just voice phishing. And that information is later used for a technical attack to get money or data, or we just have them go to a malicious link right there. So let's talk a little bit about why social engineering works on humans. If we're also aware of social engineering, why can't we stop it just by knowing about it? To understand this, we need to walk through Cialdini's six principles of persuasion from his book, Influence. The first one is reciprocity. If you offer something first, people will feel a sense of indebtedness, which will make them more likely to comply with your subsequent requests. So we are hardwired as human beings to be reciprocal, and a social engineer knows this. They'll give you a false piece of information to encourage you to reveal information about yourself. Like, I'm not gonna come right up to somebody and say, what operating system do you use? Instead, I'm gonna say, I'm having a really hard time with my Mac. Can you help me with this? Are you familiar with Macs? Do you have one? You're more likely to reply and comply if I ask you a question in a little bit of a confusing manner. The second one is commitment and consistency. We have to make thousands of choices every single day. To make it easier, we tend to make single decisions and then apply that same logic over subsequent decisions. A social engineer knows that if you start building rapport with somebody, you start giving them information, that they're likely going to continue. Because you don't want to just stop cold turkey in the middle of your conversation with someone. That makes you feel inconsistent and irrational. So if I have somebody on the phone, we've already been talking for 20 minutes, and I start really digging deep, asking about the softwares that they use, or asking them to go to a link, they've already been talking with me for 20 minutes. At this point, we're friends. I know about their dog, right? They don't want to be like, wait, I'm sorry, who are you again? Because it makes them feel awkward. But that's something that we need to do anyway. We'll get to that. The next one is social proof. We trust things that are endorsed by people that we trust. So people like experts, our coworkers, large groups of people, or our peers. A social engineer knows that they can mention or name drop other people that you might know, that they can find open source in your life on LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook. You might not even have one, but they might mention you there. And by finding you, they know who to name drop in their call or email. So people don't want to feel left out. They want to feel included and as a part of the group. So what they're going to do is comply if I mention that your best friend at work also complied. The next is liking. We tend to trust things that we like. That's pretty obvious. But this means that people make split-second decisions based on perceived characteristics, things like voice tone. A social engineer will do their research to behave in a manner that is similar to their target, and in a manner that they feel that other person might appreciate. So one example of this is, I actually look up YouTube videos and Instagram videos of my targets to see how they sound, their cadence, their voice, the words that they use. If you say dope a lot, I'm also gonna say dope on our call. I'm gonna mirror that, because it's more likely that we're gonna build trust, we're gonna become friends in 20 minutes, and now I've hacked your company. The next one is authority. We follow along with people who sound like they know what they're doing. Targets assess this by things like titles, tone, and preparedness. So a lot of times I'll choose a high status pretext, that's who I'm pretending to be. I might call somebody's boss's boss's boss, for example. But it's not just having the title that matters. You also have to walk the walk and talk the talk. So my voice will change, and we'll go through some examples of how my voice sounds differently when I'm coming from a high status pretext or a low status pretext when we get to the scripts a bit later. And then the last one here is scarcity. We're more likely to act under a sense of urgency. Social engineers know this by, they understand that if they time box a request, they're more likely to get you to comply. So something that I've seen social engineers do is say something, they might play a sound of an airplane taking off in the background, something like that. And they're like, hey, I'm so sorry. Sorry, my plane's about to take off. If you could just go to this link real quick. Sorry, I really need it before it takes up. You know, they're gonna really have a sense of urgency going there. You're way more likely to comply if you hear that sound of an airplane taking off than if I just say, I need you to go to this link right now. It's like, that's creepy, no, I'm not gonna do that. So what information are social engineers looking for? What are we looking for to build rapport? What do we need to know about people in order to be able to hack them? The types of information that we're targeting, I can best kind of display this in terms of the SECTF, that social engineering capture the flag. So if you think about the different pieces of information, we can call these flags. They have different point values associated to them based on how much damage you could do with that potential information. So let's talk a little bit about how much each thing is worth. So which operating somebody uses is worth 10 points, but the version of that operating system is worth more. And then what browser somebody uses is worth 5 points, but the version of that browser is worth 8 points, because of course, you can tailor things more if you know their exact versions. SEs are also really interested in things like what mail client you use, what antivirus, disk encryption, and it's not always just because they want to tailor and exploit your machine. Sometimes they can use that and pretend to be a vendor. So they might say something like, let's say I know you use Norton antivirus. I might call you and say, hey, this is Angela over at Norton. We just got a call that your office is Norton just went down, so we want to do a quick check and make sure that it's up to date. Can you tell me a little bit about your machine? Let's get started here. So we don't necessarily need that for a technical attack, though it could be used for something like that, but it's something that could be used to build rapport and credibility quickly. The highest point value during the SECTF is 26 points, and that is getting someone to go to a fake malicious URL over the phone. We don't actually send them to real malicious URLs because we don't actually want to take down their company. We just want to simulate that they did it, so they have to confirm that it really did happen. The way that I get people to go to these fake malicious URLs is not just by asking outright. I need to actually have a reason to be calling them and asking them to do that. So what I need to do is understand their personal preferences. I need to know information about their likes, their dislikes, so I can build rapport with them quickly so I can get them to go to that link under a guise or pretext. Let's go over an example of how I would use that data. A piece of information like what service provider you use can sound useless or innocuous, but in reality, that tiny flag, that tiny piece of information, can actually lead to a complete compromise of your company. Before I started doing social engineering, I wouldn't think twice about answering someone's question like, oh, what type of phone provider do you have? Or what is your pest extermination service provider, you know, that you have at your company? I feel like, I don't even know why you need to know that, but sure, I'll tell you. Now I understand that I could use this vendor information, this service provider information, to build rapport. So your company could have state-of-the-art security with firewalls, you could have port security on, your networks could be segmented, you could use two-factor to access the VPN, but if I see during my OSINT, my open source intelligence, my recon, all of that, that I see your service provider tagged you on LinkedIn, which happens very often, more often than you might think, I can use the information from their photo to build rapport on a phone call with you. So let's say I see that your service provider is Bugs R Us or something like that for your pest extermination service provider. I see that on LinkedIn and they tagged your office manager. They have a picture of them in the office, they're smiling, they want to display that they have a good relationship with their vendors and their clients. So they might say something like, we love working with X company, they're so great. They have a picture of them smiling, they have their visitor badge. Well, what I can do is I can look at that picture and I can recreate all of that. I can do an on-site social engineering attack. I would show up, I know who to ask for when I get there, I know who your point of contact is, because you tag that office manager. I know what your visitor badge should look like, so I know what to ask for and how to be prepared when I walk through the door. I know how I can make myself dress the part, right? Because I know what your uniform looks like now. And when I show up there, you're likely going to have trust if I say something like, oh yeah, Charles couldn't be here today, that guy that you usually see. They sent me instead, sorry about that. And if you trust somebody, you're more likely to give them access. That's a huge problem, right? So I might have access to unlock machines, I might be able to exfiltrate data, insert malware, AKA game over. I just bypassed every single security measure you have painstakingly set up. So let's go over a little bit about what this might look like. I actually have a video from DEF CON. I'm not sure if people have seen this before, but we can show how this action, this one piece of information, the service provider that this person uses for their phone, how that can compromise everything for that person.
So I invited a few of the world's best hackers to try to hack me and show me where my vulnerabilities are. And now I'm going to meet them in Las Vegas for DEF CON, the biggest hacker convention of the year. They're going to hack me using social engineering, which is essentially hacking without any code. They just use a phone and an internet connection.
You want to do a sample phishing call?
What's phishing?
Phishing is voice solicitation. And basically, what you do is you use the phone to extract information or data points that can be used in a later attack.
Let's do it. Who are you going to call?
Maybe I'll call your cell phone provider and see if I can get them to give me your email address.
I bet they're good. I bet they have my back. But yeah, go for it.
I'm going to spoof from your number, so it's going to look like it's calling from you.
Okay.
Hi, I'm so sorry. Can you hear me okay? I'm sorry. my husband's like, we're about to apply for a loan, and we just had a baby, and he's like, if it's done by today, so I'm so sorry. I can't call you that. I'm trying to log into our account for uses information, and I can't remember what email address we use to log the account. But he's crying, and can you help me? Awesome.
In just 30 seconds,
at gmail.com?
Jessica gets access to my personal
email. I needed to add our legal daughter on our account so she could go in and make changes. How would I need to go about doing? You would have to send me a secure pin through a text message? Yeah, well, the thing is, I don't think I'll be able to receive a text message if I'm on the phone. Oh, I'm not on there either? So I thought when we got married, he added his account.
Jess uses my girlfriend's name and a fake social security number.
5127.
To set up her own personal access to my account.
Wait, I'm sorry, so there's no password on my account right now? Can I set that up?
She even gets the support person to change my password.
Thank you so much for your help today.
So she just basically blocked me out of my own account.
I'll get her set up. All right, thank you.
Holy shit. So they just gave you access to my entire cell phone account.
You're going to have to go on and change your password right now because it's Jess, my name.
And all it took was a crying baby and a phone call.
It's terrifying, right? It's pretty scary to see that she could use that information from Facebook, maybe him complaining about using a specific cell phone service provider, and maybe talking about how much he loves his girlfriend, to set up all this information and block him out of his own account. So I tend to use social media to find the majority of this information in general. So let's walk through a little bit about which social media I use. My open source intelligence booklets that I write, they're 70 pages long, so basically a book. They're filled with pictures, posts, and statuses from my target company and all of the employees that work there. In general, I find about 60% of the information that I need to infiltrate a company through Instagram alone. And the reason why is because people post pictures from their workstation or pictures of their badges on their anniversary or their first day of work, and they tend to use hashtag blessed. Do people say that here in Sweden? Do they say hashtag blessed? It's a thing in the US. I don't get it, but people feel very blessed on their first day of work. And so do I, because now I know what all of their badges look like, and I know how to get into their, I know how to get in. I see like all of their exits and doorways and everything like this. Generally in the background of these photos are things like their computer, their badge, their client lists, their ESS ID names, passwords on a post-it note from HR because I haven't reset them yet, software details. But the single biggest problem from Instagram is the geotagged workstation photos. This is terrible. This is something we really need to work out through a social media policy for every single employee and vendor. So the big thing that I see is something just like this. Somebody's sitting back, they have their feet up on the desk. I blurt it out because I just feel bad. I don't want to just show you all their software. But their computer is just wide open and I can see everything running. I see their email. Their clients' emails are listed right there. I see what VoIP service provider they use. I can see everything that they do in their daily schedule, when they get there, how they clock in, how they clock out. And pictures of people sitting at their desk gives me every single thing I need. Their OS, browser and version, mail clients, making models of their computer, their interests from their desk photos and trinkets. And again, I can build rapport with people by getting this information and quickly using it, just as Jess did on that call to Verizon, the service provider. So you might be asking, what are the things I use other than Instagram? You can see them all here. Instagram still is the biggest thing for me. It's about 60% of all the information that I need to infiltrate the companies. Facebook is also huge, as I'm sure you might guess. But in general, I use a tool called Searches Back. It's an OSINT tool, open source intelligence, and you basically use special search operators, I call it Facebook lurking, if you're familiar with Google lurking, to find information about people that they believe to be hidden. So the big thing that I'm seeing on Facebook, my hacking of choice is phishing over the phone. But the only way that you can do that is if you have a phone number, right? And not every person has a phone number publicly listed places. And sometimes I'm looking for a cell phone, an old cell phone maybe, that I can try and call. The biggest thing that I see people do is they actually dox themselves prior to ever getting a job on Facebook. So do you remember back in like 2010, 2009, people had, they would lose their cell phone, right? And so they would say, they would create these groups on Facebook that said, I have a new phone number, everybody join this group and give me your phone number here. So you'd see the person's name and they would just drop their phone number in there. Well, what they didn't realize is that Facebook might have changed some policies, or they might not have realized back in the day that that was a public group. And through my Facebook lurking, using those special search operators, I can find their cell phone number. I can give them a call. And they're not seeing it coming because they don't think their cell phone is listed anywhere. So that's a big challenge. I would recommend it for everybody in the audience. See if you doxed yourself in 2009. Another good one is Twitter. I do a lot of hashtag and picture searching there. It's not as useful. They have really good search operators that you can do there, but people in general don't tend to post as much information about their lives on Twitter. They tend to just write about things. Me too. LinkedIn is really good for vendors. So I can see their vendors tagging pictures with their client success stories. They want to prove that they're doing a good job, right? They want to prove that they have clients and that everybody should book them. But in doing so, I know who to masquerade as. Next up, Quora and Reddit. They're really good tell-alls for employees from the company, basically people spilling their secrets about what they love and hate about the company. And if I see secrets about what they hate about the company, I can use that to build credibility on a phone call posing as an insider. So something that I might do, and I do all the time, is I will call as an employee who's traveling from one office to a satellite office. I might find somebody who's posted online about their travels. And I'm going to pretend to be them. So in effect, I'm going to ask for help from somebody, and I'm going to use those details from somewhere on social media. And if I can act like that person, I know their likes, their dislikes, I can start to get more information out of people, because I don't seem like this odd outsider. I know that the Wi-Fi sucks at X location. I know that the food's going to be bad when I get there, and I can complain about that on the phone. The last one, I didn't include it up here because it's not technically social media, but Google Maps is really, really helpful for a social engineer. And the reason is that I can see different vendors that you use in Google Maps. Sometimes Google Maps will snap a picture of a truck going by, and I know that you might use that service. Or I might see your dumpster service provider on Google Maps. They don't always obfuscate that. Sometimes you can just see what you use. So I might call an office manager and pretend to be from that dumpster service provider and gain credibility and access from there. So I mentioned Instagram, that's the big one. 60% of all flags are found there. Let's go through how I do it, just so you know. In terms of what I'm doing on Instagram, I'm uncovering the public and open source content about companies by typing in the target company into the search bar on Instagram. And then the first thing I do is click places on the right. This will bring you to any post that is geotagged to addresses that company might have. Oftentimes there's hundreds here. It does take a while to comb through. There's thousands and thousands of pictures, but many times there are all these feet up on the desk photos. I can see information about machines in the background, or again, I can find information about likes and dislikes from the employees at that company. Let's go through a little bit about how I pick who I'm going to call. Those are my targets. And we'll go through some solutions too, so it's not just gonna be all fear, uncertainty, and doubt. The first is, if it's your job to help, I am much more likely to contact you. If you have a job where you're required to give information to people, right? You're required to reply to somebody's email within a certain SLA, something like that. I'm definitely gonna contact you because you're more likely to give me the information I need in a time-boxed way. So the types of jobs that I target most often are people in finance, that's pretty obvious, we see that a lot. Customer support, sales, and then the things that might not be as obvious are the jobs like special events and hiring managers. And I go through these, I call them soft targets, because they're not expecting me to call. They also don't have scripts. And so if I'm calling customer support, sometimes I'll do this because I have a phone number and it's easiest just to fish those phone numbers, but they have a script. They're prepared to shut me down. Who's not prepared to shut me down? The special events manager who sets up places like this, right? They're not used to people calling and trying to get a bunch of information in a malicious way. Usually, if you can masquerade as a company they work with, they will just give you all the information and you can have access. So let's go through an example of what I might say to somebody in customer support. So if I were to target somebody in customer support and pretend to be somebody pre-texting as a customer of their company that needs help with troubleshooting, I would give pieces of information about myself and get them to correct me. I might say something that I know is intentionally wrong, or I might give them pieces of information that are right, but odd, to get them to tell me more about themselves. I might say, my computer is not loading. I don't understand what's going on. Maybe it's because I'm on a Dell instead of a Mac. Does it work on your Windows computer? Do I need a Mac? And they'll say, no, it works on my Windows computer just fine. And I'd be like, oh, well, that's good. Maybe I just need to use my other one, but it's really old. It's like Vista. Is it gonna work on that? And they might say something like, oh yeah, well, we use XP and it still works on that, so it's fine. I might also say something like, maybe your website won't work for me because I'm on an old operating system. Mine says version 15.0.1104. Is it working for you on that version? A social engineer knows how to walk these people through how to find their versions. So you're gonna get a lot of times on the phone, somebody says, I don't know how to find that. And a social engineer will say, see that little Apple thing in the upper left-hand corner? Click that, and then click about this Mac, right? They know how to walk people through that stuff. That's something to look out for. One for special events, if I'm gonna target somebody in special events, I might say something like, for some reason, our presentation for the gala has not been working on Wi-Fi outside of the office, unless our tech guys load it up. I don't get it. What's your Wi-Fi info? I'll have Craig set it up before we get there so you don't have to run around day of. A lot of times, we're trying to take the work from other people, right? We're not gonna say, give me your Wi-Fi information. Like, that person's gonna be like, no, you're rude, please go away. But instead, I'm gonna say, let me take this load away from you, right? I don't want you to have a bunch of extra work. A lot of times I'll say, I don't wanna have to call you on the weekend. You know, that's gonna suck. And they're like, well, damn, I don't wanna pick up the phone on a Saturday. I better help this girl, right? The next thing in my Venn diagram of how I pick a target for social engineering is, I'm generally looking for people who lack security training. So in addition to finding people whose role it is to help others, I'm finding people that don't have that script, as I mentioned, and they also don't have the context to know what they should answer and what they shouldn't. And a social engineer is gonna use commitment and consistency to get as many pieces of information out of you as fast as they possibly can. So a big thing that you'll see at the SECTF, at DEF CON, if you go and watch it, is the questions are rapid fire. They don't give them a second to breathe. So they're gonna ask something, they're gonna get away from their protocol, they're gonna get them thinking on their feet. And when people think on their feet and they don't have context, they make mistakes. Even a knock agent, I called a knock agent at DEF CON and I got them to go to a fake malicious URL over the phone within 8 minutes, right? This person is trained, but if I can ask questions fast enough, I can get him off his script. The third major category that my targets share is that there are posts about them on social media. I mentioned before, it might not necessarily be you who's posting on social media, but it might be a friend, a coworker, a vendor, and that can still make you a target. So when seeing that type of information online, I am going to pose as that company, vendor, or friend, friend of a friend of a friend, and try and use that as my pretext to gain credibility with you. So as an example, let's say you take a photo with your best friend from work while you're both working from home together in the same location. You use hashtag your company motto, like Life at Security Fest or something like that. And your workstation might be in the background. Now I can see all the software you run, what type of email you use, specific messaging applications that you might use. And I could use this to build credibility with you. So I might say something like, hey, is this Craig? Yeah, this is Andrea over at Slack. We saw that it might be running a little slow today. Your IT group asked me to give you a call and make sure your machine was up to date so that Slack, doesn't hold you back from doing your work. That person might be like, what the heck? Nobody from Slack's ever called me before, but they know the name of my team and they know my manager's name, so I guess I should probably go with it. But I can find that all from Twitter, LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram. And you have to make sure that if people are posting about you, that you have to kind of be aware, look that up, and see what type of information is about you. I'm sure we're all politely paranoid here, so I'm sure you've Googled yourself enough. But check it out and be aware so that you don't let people authenticate with that publicly available information that you might not even post it yourself. So there's the Venn diagram. Let's walk through some examples about how each section differs, because I don't just hit people in the middle, I'll hit people on all ends of this Venn diagram. So if it's your job to help others and you lack security training, you're a great target, but it might be hard for me to find your contact information if I can't find it somewhere on social media. And again, the type of people who have their contact information listed publicly available tend to have scripts. So that's like customer support or something like that. And I want to hit a softer target, usually. If you lack security training and I have your contact information from social media, it is highly likely that I'm going to at least ping or try and reach out to see if that's an avenue or a way in to your company's data. If I can find a way to quickly build credibility by dropping, a coworker's name or a software that you use or a vendor, it's highly likely that I'm going to continue down that avenue with you as a target. And if I can find you on social media and it is your job to help people, I might have enough information to build rapport and credibility quickly. But if every person falling into this category has security training, I'm highly likely to get shot down. And this has happened before. When I get shot down, I get super excited. People say, I'm sorry, who are you calling with again? Or I thought they usually had Allison do this, not Rachel. Who's that? This is great, right? This is something that I really hope to see through all of my trainings. In general, when I get that wall, I hang up and I just pick a new target at that company, whoever's hired us. But if I get person after person, soft target after soft target shutting me down, your company's pretty locked down. That's pretty impressive. But that's why it's important to train every single member of your team, not just the people who are in tech or not just the people in finance or the people who deal with clients, because in general, a social engineer, if they're not super lazy, they're gonna go for a softer target. Finally, the perfect target. If I can find your contact info, your preferences from social media, I can build rapport and credibility fast with you. And if it's your job to help me, you're really likely to comply, and you want security training on top of that, I can likely gain access to your data within minutes. In the case of the social engineer and capture the flag at DEF CON, it's usually within 30 seconds to 8 minutes. Let's go over a little bit about how I pick my pretext. So this is who I'm pretending to be. And it's more than just a lie. Does anyone know what this GIF is from? Catch me if you can. So that's Leo, of course, but playing Frank Abagnale Jr. pretending to be a pilot, one of the most prolific social engineers of all time. And if you've seen that movie, you know that he doesn't just use somebody's name. He doesn't just walk up there and only have a uniform. He knows the lingo. He knows what words to say, the order to say them, the tone. And he knows everything about how they dress, right? So same thing with me for social engineers. In general, I'm picking a target and I'm picking my pretext based on the amount of information that I have on someone. So in general, I want to pretext or pretend to be an insider. I'm going to look for somebody who posts a lot of information about themselves so that I can assume their identity. I basically wear their skin. I become that person for the next 2 weeks during this engagement. And I'm going to know about their travels, their preferences, their likes, their dislikes, everything about what they do or don't do at work, their coworkers' names. And I'm going to go for people that I know they don't have strong connections to, but are aware of. So, right, it's going to be persons that people they've seen on the right-hand suggested side on LinkedIn, but that they haven't added. That's a person I'm going to go as. Let's go over the ways that I might attempt to attack as a social engineer. Pretty obvious, we all know this, but I'll walk through the mitigations as well. So we have email, phone, and in person. And phone can be text, social media, anything like that. So first, in terms of email, if you're trying to spot a social engineer, we all know this one, don't click on links, that's pretty obvious. But the little things you might look for in these emails are, they're slightly off, but they're possible. It's a vendor that we use, and it looks like the email, but there's just one thing wrong. Or, I do use this company, I have posted on Twitter frequently about purchasing from this company, but I don't remember purchasing this specific item. Or, I have a flight coming up, but they got the time wrong, right? Slightly off, but definitely possible. The next thing that you might see over email is people asking for personal information. So passwords, social security, credit cards, money transfers, or you know they're talking about social media or something like that they've seen you on. Creepy, these things are pretty obvious. We all know the bad spelling and grammar that goes into phishing emails. And then the other thing that we can be aware of is urgent requests, that time boxing. They're gonna try and get it from you now, now, now. A lot of times vendors or companies that we work with aren't gonna try and scare us, right? But a social engineer will. And of course, their email address might be from an external domain or something that you're not expecting. In terms of a phone, how you might spot a social engineer on the phone, the biggest thing is that they are gonna call you out of the blue. And that's gonna be weird, because a lot of times we don't accept phone calls from people anymore, right? If we see phone numbers that we don't expect, we're just gonna shut it down. But the thing that a social engineer does is they're gonna spoof a number that they know that you know, but not super well. And so you're more likely to pick it up. If this type of number is calling you out of the blue, be wary of it. Unscheduled inspections, urgent requests, people coming from positions of power, if your role is to help others in any way, whether it's you're a mother, you're a father, you're a manager, that is the type of person that a social engineer will go after, because they know that you have a role to play and that you're more likely to be, you know, coerced into clicking on something. And then in person, these are really fun. So how to spot a social engineer in person. A social engineer person is the type of person who's gonna have their hands full. They're not a person with a hoodie who's just sneaking around. They are gonna look like they belong. In general, that person will be standing upright, they're gonna be talking to you with a lot of gestures, but they're gonna be carrying something heavy, maybe a box of donuts or a big computer or something like that. They're trying to get you to open the door, or they're trying to build rapport with you so that you connect with them and you let them in. They might have a badge that looks pretty reasonable, but is slightly off. And they're gonna be very purposeful in their actions. So a social engineer doesn't slink around, they're not creepy, they're not hiding, they're actually very purposeful. They're walking in strong movements. And they're gonna stand upright, they're gonna look you directly in the face, and they're gonna pretend like they belong, and they probably look like they will too. This type of person is going to be a sweet talker. They're gonna have excuses for everything, and they might be very apologetic. So, I'm so sorry, I just wanna get out of your hair, or, you know, I'll just get out of your way in 10 minutes, right? Something like that. They know that if they say, they acknowledge the fact that they are bothering you, that they're more likely to get you to comply. Okay, so what can we do about this? We have all these people, these crazy people going around, they're trying to attack us, what do we do? Awareness is huge, so that's the first thing. Everybody here, I'm sure, is super aware, but your employees might not be aware. The people that you work with might not be aware. Bring this up to them, let them know. Show them a copy of this video, whatever. And you wanna make sure that always you have two-factor for everything, because a social engineer is gonna try and gain access, and they get thwarted a lot of the times by 2FA. And the last thing, something people have touched on a lot here today, is positive reporting culture is key. Set it up in a way that you can get people to report and you reward them for doing so. When they report, doesn't matter if it actually was a fish or somebody weird walking through their office, if you can get somebody to come up to you and say, I just saw this guy, do we know who this is? Right? We want that. It's politely paranoid. That's a good thing. You want people to challenge people who walk around your office and you might not know them. And so if you can get your company comfortable with saying, stopping people and saying, sorry, excuse me, do you need help with something? That's good. You want them to practice that. In terms of phishing in the phone, awareness, if you ever feel weirded out by somebody, if people are time boxing requests, if they call to you, if they're trying to build rapport with you just too much, hang up on them. Do not even try and get clarifying questions out there because they will be able to talk through every single one. It is totally fine to hang up on people. I hang up on legitimate people every day. And then in terms of on-site attacks, it's that awareness, your physical security, your CrypSec, asking people, can I help you? And of course, that positive reporting culture. Make it so that it's not weird in your world for people to question things. If you can do that, you can pretty much, you know, take on the majority of social engineers because they're not gonna see that coming. So let's get into what it looks like at DEF CON. We'll go through some scripts and some sounds of what it might sound like on a phishing call. Here I am in the booth for the past couple of years, terrifying, but really fun. The pretexts that I tend to choose vary widely. So they're based on the type of person that I'm calling. If I'm calling somebody who I know will appreciate a low status pretext, I might pretend to be somebody who doesn't know what they're doing, right? Oh my gosh, I just don't know how to use this computer. That's totally different than, you know, we had some type of incident, we wanna make sure that you're okay, that your machine's up to date, and it's gonna change based on tone and who I'm calling. So let's go through what my SE calls sound like. The majority of these calls are based on the Cialdini principle of reciprocation. We also use a lot of commitment and consistency, but you're gonna hear reciprocation a lot in the majority of these flags, and I'll go over a little bit about how it sounds. All of these things that you're about to hear are real. They happened in the glass booth in the last 2 years. So let's say I called a customer support training facility for my company. I'm gonna pretend to be a nervous person, okay? So. See, I'm sorry, I'm just a really nervous flyer and I've never gone to your training facility before and I just wanted to ask some questions about the process. I'm so sorry, I know this is so annoying. Is that okay? Can you help me? I cannot stand flying with my bags. If I wanted to ship my stuff there for the week, could I use UPS, FedEx? Which shipping company should I use? And I saw on Yelp or, you know, TripAdvisor that your ESSID Wi-Fi name was blah, blah, blah. Is that still correct? And then my parents are super crazy, and this is kind of my first full-time job, and so everywhere I go, they require that there are security guards there. I know this is really nuts, but I told them they have Allied Barton brand security guards there, but they want me to confirm, and I won't be able to get my training. Okay, thanks. And I have to do this stupid security awareness training thing. They make us do it every year, but I need to make sure it works at your facility. Otherwise, I won't be able to get access to the training. So could you just try it really quickly on your network and make sure it doesn't mess up? It's www.maliciousurl.com. Okay, thanks. Scene. Okay, so let's try one that's a little more high status. I called an intern as his boss's boss's boss, and I did a quick security audit, and I spoofed his headquarters number in New York. Ring, 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 ring. Hi, this is Kelly over here. We got VP of Cybersecurity. I just want to make sure the machine is up to date for Monday. We had some quirkiness on the network over the weekend, and I just wanted to make sure that you didn't have any trouble badging in, accessing your documents, all that. I'll get out of your hair in a second. I know it's a Saturday. You're still using your Dell Latitude, right? You're still on Windows 7? Okay, great. And you're using your Outlook web app version 15.0.1104. Found this on his Instagram. Oh, great, great. And we've been getting some reports that payments are showing up a day late. Have you had that issue? Oh, no? Oh, that's great. I'm glad that you're getting paid on time. When was your last payment coming through for you? And I need to make sure you're not blocked from completing the security assessment, otherwise I'll have to keep calling you tomorrow. So if you could just go to www.maliciousurl.com, that would be great. Thanks. Scene. I'm trained in the theater. So it might seem a little odd to ask some of those questions, right? Like, why do I need to know when that person gets paid? If I can use that information on a later call, it's more likely that subsequent people that I call will give me more information. And I might get escalated privileges from there because I know the specific insider information that no one else can know, right? I have to work there. So let's go, as a true millennial myself, we're gonna go through some emoji takeaways. So we now know, for photos, urge everyone you know to step away from workstations when they take a picture. And avoid taking pictures of your computer, posting statuses about work, or even just be aware of complaining about things. In cybersecurity, it does often take technical prowess to own a company quickly, but with social engineering, noobs and experienced insiders, people who've done social engineering for years, are on the exact same playing field. When I started doing social engineering, I was a complete noob. My first ever phishing call was in that booth at DEF CON, and I still got second place to a man named Chris. Number two, if you do post about it, don't let someone authenticate with that information. And again, it might not be you posting about it. So it could be helpful to get a feel for the types of things that are out there for your company, your coworkers, people around you, because people might use that information to build credibility with you and rapport on their own. So if somebody says, you know, I go for runs every week with Fred and I love it so much and it's on Instagram public, and I call them and I'm like, hey, I just did the quick security audit with Fred, it went super well, it only took 5 minutes, you're way more likely to comply because I just name dropped Fred. But that shouldn't be more likely for you to comply because anyone could know about Fred, right? Don't let people authenticate with publicly available info. And then lastly, women may have an edge in social engineering. We have seen hacktivist groups like Anonymous and LulzSec use women as a part of their attacks and their campaigns, increasingly so, because there is a way that we view women in society that actually gives women an advantage in social engineering. If I use a low status pretext, like, I just can't figure out how to troubleshoot this, I don't know, I'm so bad at computers, if I say that to a man, it is way more likely that man will help me. We call that mansploiting. Don't let that happen. Thank you. Thank you. That's it. Any questions? Hack the planet.
Do we have any questions from the crowd? One over there and one over here. So my question is, from all your experience with social engineering, have you ever had a chance to use it on a, let's say, telephone scammer or anything else?
Yes. I have seen Kevin Mitnick, you know the famous hacker Kevin Mitnick, he does this all the time. He will keep people on the phone for hours and just get more information out of them and then post their information on Twitter and then all the social engineers go after them. That's hilarious. But a lot of times I'm trying to gain information about who's calling me and that's really fun, and then they get scared and then they don't call me ever again. So
you said it's easier to exploit men, but how about women?
Women, I have found that the cohort of women that is 40 to 50 years old, if I, as a young woman, am calling them, they're impenetrable. I cannot get information out of that cohort at all. So thank those women in your life. They're keeping your data safe. But younger women, sometimes if I am like buddy-buddy with them and I talk about, you know, our dogs that we have and how much fun we're gonna have on the weekend, I can build rapport with them pretty quickly. But yeah, those women are like, I don't give a crap.
So how do you go about practicing your social engineering skills, like hacking firmware? You can always just do that over and over and over again. How do you go about that?
Yeah, like most creepy things, it's just doing it on people who don't know you're doing it. So a lot of times I'll do it with service providers and just see how much information I can get out of them. When I first started doing social engineering, I wasn't sure exactly how to like attack a real company, right? And I wasn't sure about the legal. I didn't have a lawyer yet, so I didn't want to start doing that on my own. So what I would do is I would call my cable service provider, or I would call a doctor's office, or my dog's pet insurance, and I would see how far I could get calling somebody else. With my pet insurance, I was actually able to get all the way through and authenticate with publicly available information, and I never gave them my real information. Now, of course, I was calling, I knew that information, I was me, but I pretended to be somebody else. So it's just an interesting practice, but it is very creepy. I also do it in the mirror. Yeah, it's weird.
Have you ever had any instances where you've done a campaign against a company or whatever, and then employees are extremely upset and hurt about it and are offended by the employer for hiring you?
I think I've been really lucky that hasn't happened to me. And I think the reason is that when I'm working with companies, I also vet them back. So are they the type of company that has an open, positive reporting culture, or are they just trying to fire somebody, right? If they're the type of company that after I give them an OSINT report, they just fire the three people whose Instagram leaked all that information, it's not gonna work for us, right? And so I'm gonna go after companies who are, they want to learn, and they see this as a learning opportunity, and they promise that they're not gonna get anybody in trouble. In fact, when I give them the OSINT report, it's completely scrubbed, so you can't see who posted what. I'm just saying that I found this. And then sometimes I'll privately have those conversations with people like, hey, are you blah, 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 blah on Twitter? Because I see everything. So you might want to scrub that, let's talk about it, right? And so it's more of a conversation and less of like FUD, you know, where I'm like, you screwed up. Because people don't know. And if they don't know, they can't do anything about it. But once they're getting educated by their company, they're doing the right thing. And they're excited about it.
Do you think the GDPR will make it harder for you to do social engineering due to that people will be educated?
I hope so. I hope GDPR helps in that way. I guess that remains to be seen. I really don't know.
One more from Eric.
I'll let you get on the mic for the live stream.
How often do you get caught?
Rarely. I would say it's like 1 out of every 100 calls. One call during the SECTF, I was calling that knock agent that I told you about, and they gave me every piece of information about their machine, their, you know, everything. Yeah, they went to the fake malicious URL twice. And then I asked them about their work schedule, which is one of the smallest point value flags, and they were like, I'm sorry, who is this again? I was like, Kyle? So yeah, I don't know. Sometimes the weirdest stuff gets you caught, but then you just hang up.
Is there like, I know you can do like phishing trainings to your employees. Is there any like advice you have for doing this internally or like teaching about social engineering internally that you would recommend?
Yeah, so we do this through social proof security. That's part of the thing that we do. I found that the only real way to institute change that's positive is actually getting people a chance to hack. So unless they step into the shoes of a hacker and actually are given a target and they try it for at least 30 minutes, things don't stick. Because death by PowerPoint does not work for this stuff. You can make it fun, right? You have to just actually train them and make it fun and interesting and hands-on. And when we do that, we see amazing results. But if we just do PowerPoint stuff, it's just like snooze fest.
How do you make sure that what you're doing is legal?
Lawyers. I got a lawyer.
That's a good answer. Are there any more questions? We might have time for one more, if there's anyone. One right here, okay.
Yes, I was just thinking about the social media. Can you plant stuff there? As in, we use these computers, or we use these vendors, or anything as a flag for if anyone ever mentions this, you're in trouble.
Oh, that is such a good idea. I've never thought of that. I'm gonna steal that. That's gonna be my idea, okay? Yeah. That's an amazing idea. Yeah, you can, and that would be really cool. You should totally do that. Would you call that like a canary or something? Like if somebody ever mentions that you use Bugs R Us, you know they're trying to have publicly available information.
It's actually brilliant.
It's brilliant. I never thought about that.
So thanks so much for this. We don't have time for any more questions, unfortunately, but you'll be around during dinner and afterwards. So thanks once again.
Thanks.